morning, everyone. A warm welcome to all and each and everyone present here. It's a matter of great privilege for us to have amongst us the guests from Hindustan Unilever Ltd, a company which needs no introduction at all. I welcome you all, everyone here present. Taxila Business School is established to serve the society's education needs and raising the bar of management education in India. College has inculcated the art of excellence in its students through rigorous course work and a uniquely designed industry-oriented course. And I'm sure our guest is going to witness this talent over the time to come. With this, I would like to request Kishore Sharma, sir, mentor, Taxila Business School, to please present a memento to our guest of honor, Mr. Rohit Kulkarni. And to Ms. Anushka Sharma. To Mr. Rajat Garg. And to Ms. Niharika Singh.
So, my point being, it's brands that are powerful. And Hindustan Unilever is the company which makes brands powerful. Correct? So, we are going to have a small presentation for you. And before we begin that, we have a small announcement. Can all the people who are shortlisted raise their hands for me? Okay. So, all the people from the third row onwards, if your participation is really, really, really awesome, we find you exceptional, we will shortlist you for all the rounds. Okay. So, even now, the shortlist is open if we find you exceptional. Now, it's up to you to showcase that exceptionality. All right. So I'll hand over the mic to Rohit and best of luck.
Good morning. So Rajat had just announced there is a participation reward or participation surprise. So if this good morning is this way, then I don't think anybody will participate. So good morning.
Good morning, sir.
That's perfect. So that's like Taxila. Okay. So guys, this is a small presentation what we are going through. What we will do here is, we will take you through the entire journey of how Unilever has been built up, which brands we are working with, what kind of a business we operate with, and then we'll take it further, with Niharika's permission, we'll take it further the next rounds. So I'll just start with the... Okay. Perfect. So how many states we represent generally in this hall? Entire country? Just like Unilever, we operate almost like 190 countries. So I think entire 29 now, 29 states? 28, okay. Perfect. We are just setting up the presentation. So before that, Rajat, have you introduced? We as an, I'll just give you a brief introduction of three of us standing here. So Rajat handles the part of Rajasthan as in a business. So we as in a company, we operate here within a central branch. We work within a central branch. As in a Hindustan Unilever, we have 5 branches to operate with, which is north, east, south, west. And 5 years back, the branch got crafted as the central branch. So central branch consists of 5 states, which are UP, Bihar, MP, Chhattisgarh, and Rajasthan. So there are 2 offices to be set up. One office is in Lucknow, which handles the part of Bihar and UP. And there is an office in Indore, which take care of the 3 states, which are MP, CG and Rajasthan. So Rajat looks after a part of a business from Rajasthan. Anushka take care of a part of a business from Chhattisgarh. And I take care part of an MP, which is Madhya Pradesh. So that's how the branch structure is. All the ASMs who are handling this business are based out of Indore. And there are a few managers who sits in Lucknow. They take care of a UP and Bihar part of it. Rajat asked you how many brands or how many of you know Lever, I think most of us know. The one who want to enter into FMCG business, I don't think he can turn around and say, I don't know HUL or I don't know Unilever as such. Unilever operates with so many brands that it's really hard for us also to remember how many brands we actually operate with. In totality, we operate 35 plus brands and most of them are displayed here. This is a small footprint of ours where we as an HUL or we as an Unilever operate in 190 countries across globe. We have a strength of around 1.73. We have a strength of around 1.73 lakhs employees across the globe, which are on payroll kind of and stuff, which includes a lot of factories, which include a lot of other profit centers, and obviously the sales team. Apart from that, the biggest strength or the biggest USP what Unilever has is we touch 2 billion life every day. We claim we touch 2 billion life every day. So right from your teething your brush till the night cream you apply in the night, everything we operate with. So as an HUL, as an Hindustan Unilever, we claim it every 9% out of 10 we reach with our brands, and that's the power of HUL brands, and there is no further introduction required. We have a head office situated in Mumbai, and as I told you, we operate with 5 branches. We have north, south, exceptionally north is in Noida or Gurgaon, central is in Lucknow, Mumbai again, the west branch is in Mumbai. South branch operates again with the 2 clusters, which is Chennai and Bangalore, and Eastern branch operates on from Calcutta. That's about Unilever HUL. Next. Okay. This is something very unique, and this is something very we take pride about it. We operate within a purpose. So every individual has their own purpose, and we as in a company, we operate with our own purpose. We said any brand who works with a purpose probably has the 30% more reachability or 30% more growth path than any other brand who doesn't operate with a purpose. And we as an Unilever has a very, very unique purpose, making sustainable life a commonplace. And I can explain it in a bit way. How I can say a sustainable life? Take example of one of our brand called Kisan. I think most of you heard it. You heard it?
Yes.
It's a skin cream, right?
Yeah.
No?
Okay.
It's a ketchup and jam. So we operate with Kisan, and Kisan has this procurement of tomatoes from which the ketchup and the probably the other fruits. So we as a brand say whichever the land we take these tomatoes from should be sustainable land for next 50 more years. So that's how we operate it. So we don't use the fertilizers which are harmful for that particular soil or that particular state and something of that sort. So this is something called a sustainable life. Sustainable life for that farmer, sustainable life for that vendor, or probably sustainable life for the consumer. An entire thing which operates is around consumers. So we as in a company think if the consumer is happy, then entire ecosystem will work properly. And that's what our purpose is, to make sustainable living a commonplace. Every individual who works with HUL is assigned with this purpose.
Mentor was telling me that you guys all study digital marketing.
Correct.
So, have you ever come across the word purpose while studying digital marketing? Kabhi purpose ke baare mein baat hua hai? How digital marketing can be a tool to really propagate the purpose of brands that we are promoting? Has anyone talked to you about that? No. So, like Rohit gave an example of Kisan, I would also like to give you an example of Lifebuoy. So Lifebuoy pe kuch saal pehle tak ek ad aata tha. Us ad mein there used to be a guy who's walking on his hands to a temple. And once he reaches the temple, that's when his entire journey ends. And why he goes to the temple is because his child had turned 5. So the purpose of Life Boy,
we operate in a lot of social causes. Women empowerment. We as in a company, we have a channel called Shakti Channel, which is the most recognized channel across the world. And this channel is nothing but the empowerment of a woman, a single woman in a small village town of a population 2,000 or 5,000 population. She operates as a single entrepreneur, and she delivers the business for us, for HUL, and we call it Shakti Amma. So she is the one who actually go to the door to door, or probably the town to town and village to village, and she deliver our products. Not only she do a business for us, but she actually earns for her own family, and that's what we call a Shakti project, which is the empowering woman. And this has been recognized across the globe very well. We have almost 1 lakh, right? We have almost 1 lakh Shakti Ammas in HUL currently working on roles. We take a lot of pride in water management. As I said, Lifebuoy is one of the leading brands who is actually initiating the hygiene part of a business. So we are actually educating. There are a lot of Swachh Bharat Abhiyan we are participating into. So with the Domex and the Lifebuoys and Lux of the world, we are actually entering into this kind of a business where we are actually giving government a good support for all these toilets which are getting built up in rural. Which are been getting built up in this rural India. We are doing a lot of work on that front. Plastic waste management is something which are coming up. We are the first company to announce, if you have read this across, we are the first company to announce, yes. So we are the first company to announce that we will actually the use and throw plastic, we will stop using it. Most of our CLDs, which is the cartons in which we get packed, the product gets wrapped. Now we have removed the plastic out of it. So we are the company, we are going forward to remove the usage of plastic, and that is the one of the first company. I take pride about it, that we are the first company in the India to do that stuff. Sanitization, again I told you, with the help of Lifebuoy, previously KCL was with us, now it is not. But then we are doing a lot of projects on sanitization part of it in India. And that's all about HUL. And now I'll come to the section where we actually work with. We work with, as I told you, customer development. So it's our day-to-day job is to meet customers, meet consumers. We are the face of HUL to the consumers. So every day a consumer who buys a product from an outlet or a retail channel is actually our end customer. It's probably our end destination. And we operate in a customer development scenario where we operate with three principles: demand capture, demand generation, and demand fulfillment. I'll just explain you a bit about it. Demand capture. Can somebody tell me what is demand capture?
What is the going on in the market? And what is the demand of the customer and customer?
Can somebody else?
Yes, you're right.
What is demand capture?
Right at the back.
Somebody?
Yeah.
Ma'am, you need to be slightly louder.
Market research.
Market research, yes, part of it. Very nice. Somebody else?
Yeah.
Okay. So demand capture is something, I can give an example of demand capture is something where a consumer going to a market and actually asking for a Clinic Plus shampoo. So in that particular zone, it might be the hard water which is being used, or probably take an example of Jaipur, I'm not very sure, but take an example of a Jaipur and a rural town of Rajasthan, a person goes to an outlet and asks for a Clinic Plus shampoo. This is something called a demand capture, where we know in that particular area there is a demand for this particular product. It's not only the actual demand capture, but as she said it rightly, market research also comes as a part of demand capture. So we do a lot of research about it, and then we come up with a product. So that might be in terms of CD, in terms of customer development, it is all about the retail and the consumer part of it. In a larger perspective, yes, market research is also part of demand capture. Demand generation. Can somebody? Yeah, ma'am.
Aware the people and generating
Yes. Yes. Creating a need. Perfect answer. Yeah. Problem recognition and creating a demand. Yes. So that partially comes under demand capture. What you are talking about, analyzing demand, this comes under capture. Yes. So all about generating interest, all about awareness creation, stuff like that, which comes under demand generation. So these schemes which you see, buy one get one or something of that sort. We never operate with buy one get one, but something of that sort comes under demand generation. And what about demand fulfillment? This is the most important part of an CD function. Yes, that is the job. Better get this product and deliver it to the end consumer. That is what the demand fulfillment is. So there is a huge demand of something, but then if you are not capturing it properly and giving it back to the consumer, you might lose out on a consumer for a life. So the most important part of an CD function which we operate in, customer development team operates with, is demand fulfillment, where whatever the demands we are getting in, we should be aware, we should be available, and we should be reachable to the outlets at the last leg. The population town, I told you, 2000 population town where my Shakti Amma goes and deliver the product home to home, that is what my demand fulfillment is. So that is what we are actually built up. That is what the entire CD system is all about. Okay, so I think this is more or less what about HUL, what about Unilever as such. But then now I would like to Anushka and Rajat also on stage to answer any Q&A if you have. If you have any question and answers to be asked for, not only related to this placement activity, but anything regarding HUL, we all are here.
Even outside HUL, if you have any questions regarding the economy, how you think it affects the FMCG space, anything that comes to your mind which is relevant for us and what we can answer for you, we'll be happy to help. And this is the time for you to shine. All the people who are not sitting in the first three rows, we'll judge you basis the questions you ask.
The lady first.
The budget 2019 was mostly focused on infrastructure as well as roadways. So what is your opinion like for the FMCG sector in our country?
So see, for FMCG, the biggest problem is volumes. We transport big volumes, be it soaps, be it powders, be it bars. We have big volumes which are traveling from point A to point B. If the government invests in infrastructure, in roadways, it makes our job easier to reach more far-flung corners of the country. So for example, in the last 4-5 years, the roadways in Rajasthan has developed really, really well. And that has allowed us to go and reach towns and villages which we weren't able to go 10 years back. And when we go and directly service these retail outlets, these small kirana shops in a village, we are able to get more product. We are able to tell them why that product, what that product is for, and how can the consumer actually use it. So what it eventually does is it eventually passes on more information, more product, and at the same time we are able to of course increase our sales as well. So it's indirectly a very, very good sign for us if the Indian government increases the roadways and infrastructure in the country.
Thank you, sir.
Also, please say your name out loud when you are asking a question.
Anupam Chaturvedi. Sir, I'm asking, I have seen the lot of product you're making by the plastic, like you're talking about the surfactant, sir. So what HUL are doing for the, detection for the plastic, and what we are doing for the taking the surfactant in the new packing?
So a lot of brand related packaging changes we'll not discuss at this point in time. But as an organization, over the last few years, we have taken a lot of initiatives even before the ban of one-use plastic conversation came into the mainstream. However, once that conversation has come into the mainstream, we recently announced two things. One was cardboard packaging for Axe, for Dios. The second thing was that currently what happens is that you've got 10 bottles of a product, it gets wrapped in plastic, then it gets placed in a cardboard box. So we are completely removing that plastic packaging of the bottles and it's going to directly go into a cardboard box. Also, whatever plastic we are using, we are trying to use reusable plastic, something which we can recycle and reuse at our own end. So these are some small initiatives which we are taking. What Surf Excel is doing exactly, I will not be able to answer.
No, sir, I am not asking for this, but I am asking this because a lot more of the consumer or customer are more related about this, key what plastic goes out and what's come in apart from the plastic. So that's why I'm asking you. It is the almost customer demand also.
So Anubhav, just to add what Rajat has said, we are in a process to replace plastic, but at this point of time we won't be able to share what we are doing currently because that is something a very secretive kind of stuff. But yes, definitely it's work in progress. And over the years, we all will see how HUL is actually moving from an non-plastic usage stuff. There are few things which we are definitely doing for it. And not only this, but I would like to add a point on this is that it's not maybe related to plastics, but the kind of paperwork we use it has been reduced drastically currently in HUL. So we do a lot of non-paper kind of stuff. And not only that, but then the kind of paper we use or the kind of cardboards we use, we actually assure back that we plant so many trees again in India so that we can actually helping the sustainable, the purpose of ours. We are actually making it sustainable for a common place. So not only we are reducing the usage, but simultaneously we are actually putting up a lot of efforts to put up trees and greenery part of it so that it is a long time sustainable stuff. But to the specific question, not in the right place to answer.
Also, it's not always necessary that you change the packaging of the product. Maybe you can sometimes change the product type, how the product is currently being consumed, and that automatically results in a packaging change. So a lot of different initiatives are happening in HUL at this point in time, which of course we'll not be able to discuss with you in a public forum. So, very nice question, but I'm sorry I'll not be able to give you an exact answer.
We'll take the questions, don't worry, we'll take all the questions.
Sir, many competitors are there.
Your name,
like,
please.
Bibhu Swain. Many competitors are there, like ITC, PNG, and all others are there. They are also doing up so good. So, what's your strategy to compete with them to be in the top position?
To recruit guys like you? We are doing a lot of competitive activities. Not obviously, we are in the FMCG business, and every day somebody else is coming up to do something else. So obviously, we as in a company, we have a huge research center. We have a huge development team who actually works day in, day out. There are brands who are working rigorously on every day what we can improve on, and you can see that over a period. There are a lot of things which are coming up which were not 5 years back in the system. So there are a lot of development, there are a lot of research which is happening. More or less, we are the company which known for an advertisement part of it. So if you see any normal TV channel or probably a digital media, we are the one who are actually occupying the maximum space and the mind space out of it. So that is one unique thing which we as in a company. So I won't be able to share the exact ratio, but we spend a humongous amount of money on advertisement part of it to create a brand awareness. So Maxim, what we think about it, the pull strategy, you must have all read the pull strategy. So we as in a company think pull strategy works always in consumer business. So more the pull from the consumers, more it will sell. So obviously competition is doing well, but then we are obviously one step ahead, and that's why we are the largest FMCG company.
Another example of how we compete is that you know about ITC and not HUL, but you know about a Dove more than the ITC brands. So if I ask you to list ITC brands, you probably will tell only one or two. But if I ask you about HUL brands, even if you don't know it's an HUL, maximum of the brands that you'll talk about is our brands. So that's the difference.
Thank you.
I think the essence of your question is how are we competing with Patanjali, because they have risen very fast. So Patanjali has, of course, has made an impact in the space, but what you need to understand is that Ayurvedic products were not a very big part of the FMCG space till Patanjali came in. So it's not like they took a big chunk of the current pie of the FMCG space. They made the pie bigger. That has allowed us to also come up with a lot of Ayurvedic products or natural products. And though we are probably competing with other natural brands, we are not number one there yet. But it is not as if our share of the pie, or people who are using Clinic Plus, Fair and Lovely, Lux, Lifebuoy, they have dropped. The pie itself has become bigger. The market has itself become bigger. And we are also a big part of it. So you might have heard of brands like Ayush. You might have heard about lots of variants of current brands. Clinic Plus Ayurvedic, Fal Ayurvedic, Fair and Lovely Ayurvedic. So we are also into that space. And what Patanjali has done is that it is not expanded only in the FMCG space that we exist in. It is also making biscuits. It is also making spices. We are not in that space. Their biggest product, the product that they are really competing with us on, is Dant Kranti, which is the toothpaste. In India, the number one toothpaste brand is Colgate. We are number two with Pepsodent and Closer. So the number one brand gets hit faster than the number two brand. However, in spaces where we are number one, of course we got hit, but by expanding our product base, we were able to compete. And today, though Patanjali's market share and market capital has gone down, our market capital has only gone up from last year. So at the end, I think we were able to come up with the right strategy and we competed well.
Good morning to one and all present. My name is Lavi Mittal. So my question is regarding budget 19, like after budget 19, those people who are earning less than 5 lakh, technically their income is exempt. Like basically, like suppose I'm earning rupees 100, so out of every 100 I have to pay 5 rupees tax. Now after 19 budget, I don't have to pay tax. So what's actual strategy for that 5 rupees? Are you like catering that segment also? Because after 19 budget, that 5 rupees also you can cater, right? You can sell more to the customer. So do you have any strategy for that 5 rupees?
What you're talking about is income tax.
Exactly. Like,
but HUL will not relate to income tax. We relate to corporate tax.
No. I'm talking about the thing, like, I'm a consumer, right?
You're a finance major, what?
Yeah, finance. Like,
great.
Finance and marketing.
So you are saying they have more disposable income.
Yeah. So do you have any strategy to cater that market? Because that 10 rupees is still there, right?
We are already there. So we are already in that market space. The mass segment.
You can increase your sales volume by like cater that market.
So the only thing which we can do is we can advertise more. We can ensure that we reach the last mile at the right time, at the right price. We can ensure that the person knows about the brand. But essentially, I don't think we've seen that big an uplift after the budget.
See, I'll tell you a great example of it. We actually work with a popular pricing kind of an sachet. So if you have seen, there are a lot of 5 rupees, 10 rupees kind of an sachet, and that's what the target market is. So you said it very rightly, there is a disposable income has gone up because of this tax structure, though the entire effect has not been captured yet, and we are not in a position to actually analyze what exactly the mass segment which has been freed from this income tax purpose. But still, yes. There is a price segment we operate with. It's called 5 rupee, 10 rupee segment. And these kind of people who have the lower strata of society where they want to take up this particular business, we are focusing on few products which are easily accessible kind of products. So we are working on it, and there are every brand almost in HUL operates with this kind of segment, which are the 5 rupee, 10 rupee and 50 rupee segment which we operate on. Recent example, I can say a Kisan ketchup came up with a 50 rupee packaging. This is something on a very accessible packaging to everybody, accessible package to everybody. And this is somewhat, I think, a right kind of an answer for your question. But yes, as I said, though this data is still not very much available with us, what kind of an income has been. Yeah, sure. Anushka,
what I'm asking is if there are government schemes that come in that benefit the
consumer.
No, ma'am,
actually the question is,
they have more money to spend.
Yes,
right?
Exactly.
So I'll give you a quick example of what we've done recently. So has anyone heard about the PM Ujwala scheme that came in, which was giving away LPG cylinders to rural households? You're talking about the rural people who are benefiting. So if you see, what we did was we went to these rural areas and promoted VIM. So kya hota hai, that basically they used to use ash, wood, say they used to cook. So their utensils, they would clean it with the same ash. Now what we did in these rural areas was, we went with promoters in rural areas, taught them ki bartan VIM se dhona hai. So that brand equity clicks. And these are the kind of activities that we do in rural areas to increase the strength of our brand. So obviously we have teams as ASMs, as customer marketing, we are sitting across, we are analyzing what the government is doing, different subsidies, different schemes, and how we can activate our brands. So obviously we work on those things, and as you mentioned, that 5 rupees extra if a person has, what we can do is go to those areas and promote our brands better. So all that money, like, we can't do anything else. We are already working towards creating a recall for our brands, and we have programs that go into villages and do the Nukkad Natak. So we have Nukkad Natak where we sell brands like, say, a Lifebuoy, a Lux, a Vim, a Fair and Lovely. These kind of things come under a program which is called Khushiyo Ki Doli. I'm not too sure how many of you all would have heard of it, but we do have where we sell bundled packages. So that's how we target the bottom of the pyramid through these kind of interventions.
That's more or less answers your question, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Still the income tax. We have not seen anything on that front as of now. A more specific example where you read it and in what context you read it.
Sir, in the slideshow, I have read it from China.
Are you talking about the from the distributor point of view or from the employee point of view?
Employee, sir.
Employee point of view.
So I'm not very sure the data you have read is the right data. We don't operate with this ratio 1:2 ratio. Obviously, we don't operate with that ratio. Any corporate entity you will enter into, you will find this, there will be more complications to it rather than just a human angle to it. But obviously every company has their own agenda to drive with, and then again I am repeating, the data which you are talking about 1:2 ratio,
I don't have the right answer to that.
I think, guys, more or less we have covered all the topics, and during the course of a day probably you can catch one of us and ask whatever the additional queries you have. But on this point of time, I would like to request all the people who are qualified or probably the selected ones can stay back, and rest of you can actually move out so that we can take it further. So it's a request, and yes, obviously as declared, we'll just discuss among ourselves. If somebody qualifies for the wildcard entry, we'll inform you later. I think the selected one can stay back and rest of you can go.